Meet out in public, they need to know about the kingdom of God. And what is the kingdom of God? It's not you sitting down and eating with them, but it's advancing the fact that you believe in righteousness and peace and joy. When they declared joy to the world, it didn't seem to happen automatically, did it?
No.
I mean, I don't know about you, but around the time that Jesus was being born, they were killing babies, trying to ward off the coming king. Not so much of a joyous time, huh?
That's right.
We live in perilous times. You don't have to but pick up the newspaper or turn on the evening news and you realize that we live in very perilous times. But the beauty of the gospel and the beauty of the kingdom is that we can have peace and joy even so. Even though the world crumbles around us, we can still have something solid in a relationship with Christ. Because that's what it's going to come down to anyway. Amen? Amen? I mean, listen, if a tsunami comes out of the Gulf of Mexico and washes us all away, guess what? The kingdom of God is still going to be the same.
That's right.
And you don't have to be affected by that. And some of us have been affected by similar things. We live in a state where hurricanes are very possible.
Right.
Now, for this area, it's been since 1921. We had a very mild storm season and some people were disappointed. They like to see a storm. Well, you don't like to see a storm if it washes everything you have away.
Right.
No, but still, in Christ, we can have peace and joy. Now, that's a wonderful thing. And you can see that sometimes. I love when when you have a catastrophic fire in a neighborhood, it seems like they always get somebody that has an opinion about it. I like when they get a hold of a family member that says, you know what, we've got one another.
That's right.
You know, the Lord is still with us. You know, that even in the midst of this storm, He can speak peace to our lives. And you know, they say that with a straight face because they mean it.
Right, yeah. That's right.
Not just because they've read the Bible, it's because they know the author.
Right.
They know who wrote it. They know the spirit in which it was intended, and so they have a relationship with God that keeps them standing even when this world blows them down. That's a wonderful thing to have. You're talking about security. You're talking about peace. This world wants to knock you over. The enemy of your soul is described as wanting to steal, to kill, and to destroy. To destroy what? The kingdom of God in you. See, the devil don't want you to live right. He doesn't want you to tell the truth. He doesn't want you to have peace of mind. He doesn't want you to have joy. And he's going to try everything that he can to thwart the effort of God. But praise God, here we believe in advancing the kingdom.
That's right.
One relationship at a time. On that note, we have a few people that need to be baptized and some that want to be baptized again. Amen.
That's right.
And if you need to be baptized or feel like you need to rededicate your life to the Lord in that way, praise the Lord. Step up. We've got a few more that are going to. I praise God that this past year we've probably baptized more people than we have any other year previous. And we've baptized a lot of folks. Amen. It's been a good year. Praise the Lord. I wish that everybody was here, but all of our newbies aren't here. And you know what? Next Sunday, you're not going to be newbies anymore.
Right.
Amen. Brother Ken started back in November. He's not here. He's traveling this morning. I've been so proud of him. He has been more faithful than a lot of people. as a newbie, you know, coming when every time the door's open, you know. And that's good because he's soaking it in like a sponge. And it's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing to hunger and thirst after righteousness. Why? Because you shall be filled.
Right.
Amen. That's Jesus' words. If you're hungry for the right things, if you want the right things, guess what? God will fill you. He'll fill your heart's desire. And he's the God of an overrunning cup. You don't have to live with a half cup. You don't have to live with a cracked cup. You don't have to live with a crack pot. God is the God of an overflowing cup.
That's right.
You know, we like to quote the 23rd Psalm, and we like to talk about the Lord being our shepherd. But I like that overrunning cup part. Maybe that's a good message there. My cup runneth over. Now does it? That's a good question. Does your cup run over? And if it is running over, what's it running over with? Now listen, I'm going to tell you, there's a wonderful analogy about being filled with the Spirit. And if you look at this verse, the Bible says that the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it is righteousness. And basically that means living right, honestly, soberly, in a vigilant manner about the things of God, living right. Can a man be honest? Can a woman be honest? Yes. Can they have a wholesome tongue by the Spirit of God? Yes. Can they refrain from saying things that they shouldn't say? Yes. Can a man stop cursing and start blessing? Yes. Amen. And so I say, you know, this is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. What does that mean? That means that we need to understand where our power comes from. Our power comes from the Spirit of God.
Right.
No other power, no other source but the Spirit of God. You're not doing it yourself, like we talked about last week. It's in Him that we live and breathe and have our being.
Right.
It's only because of Him that we have the opportunity to praise. And our cup should be running over with good things. I love the descriptive. And in January, we're going to have a sermon series on the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, and what it means to be Pentecostal. Because if we're not careful, we'll turn into just another run-of-the-mill social gathering. It takes the Spirit of God interacting in the lives of believers and developing the gifts that come through the Spirit to be the church that we're called to be. And our church is maturing, and as our church matures, we're going to find out that God has more than what we can imagine for us, and gifts that we cannot imagine that can operate through us and in us, but it's by being filled with His Spirit.
Right.
I love the descriptive of Stephen. They sought out men who were doing ministry to take care of things that the apostles did when they first started the church. We'll read that in Acts when we get to it. And they describe them as men being full of the Holy Ghost. I want to be full of the Holy Ghost to the point where it runs over. Full of the Spirit of God until it runs over. Full of righteousness and peace and joy until it runs over and impacts and advances the kingdom onto my brothers and sisters and onto my neighbors and my co-workers, to where that when they come to me, they're not going to get a bad report. They're not going to get a corrupt communication. They're going to get something that edifies them in love.
Right. That's right.
Now listen. Somebody like that. There's an analogy that I wanted to get to, and I heard it quite a while ago, and it says, if you have a glass of sweet tea, and being Southerners, we understand what sweet tea is, right? And I mean when you...